Insight on BCTV is supported by the Vision Resource Center.
If you face blindness and it starts to seem as though your eyes are only good for crying and you're feeling all alone, come to a place of kindness and in a new way you will see that there's much more to hope than just learning to cope. You can live a life that's full and free where the Vision Resource Center, let us be your guiding light as we strive to keep your dreams alive. Even if you lose your sight, you're not alone. Pick up the phone, we help friends and family too. We're the Vision Resource Center for people affected by blindness and low vision. We're here for.
Good morning and welcome to the December 2023 episode of Insight here on BCTV. I'd like to welcome all of our viewers. Thank you for giving us some of your time during this busy holiday season. We'd also like to welcome our two guests with us this morning. We have Dr. Elizabeth Diener, who is a doctor of optometry and an eye doctor, as well as Dori Goulden, who is a dietitian, and both of whom are at Berks Community Health Center. My name is Mark Levengood. I'm the counselor at the Vision Resource Center of Berks County. And our topic for you today is actually taking a look at diabetes and the impact that it can have on a person's vision with diabetic retinopathy and beyond. So Dr. Diener and Ms. Goulden, how are you this morning? Thank you for joining us.
Very well, thank you.
Doing well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much for giving us part of your time. And if you could start us off by just sharing big picture, what is diabetes? I mean, we've all heard of it. It's so common anymore, but what is it exactly?
So diabetes is a disorder related to the functioning of the pancreas. And your pancreas is a really important organ because in response to carbohydrate intake or ingestion, your pancreas secretes insulin. And insulin is a really important hormone which helps lower your blood sugar and get the sugar that results from ingestion of carbohydrate out of your bloodstream, where sugar can do a lot of damage.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And if you could differentiate for us between type 1, type 2 gestational and juvenile diabetes. I feel like those are often the big four that we hear about, but you know, what's the difference between them?
Yeah, so juvenile diabetes is typically also, you know, referred to as type 1, although sometimes adolescents can also develop type 2, but type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disease in which your pancreas tissue starts to attack the cells that secrete insulin. So type 1 usually occurs in children. It can also occur later in the lifespan, but usually in kids. So that's an autoimmune disease, and you must take insulin to treat that. So then you have type 2 diabetes, which typically occurs later in adulthood. And that is not an autoimmune disorder. So that basically is different because your pancreas over time just becomes, I guess you could say, almost tired. So it just becomes not great at secreting its own insulin. So with type 2, you don't really treat it the same because it has a different manifestation.
Sure.
Oh, and gestational is when you develop pregnancy, when you develop diabetes during pregnancy.
Okay. Okay. Are there any others besides those? Well, I guess it is just three because you said juvenile and type 1, they're kind of synonymous. So is it pretty much just those three?
Yeah, I mean, it is, but kind of like I was saying, so there is kind of like a latent onset of type 1 in adults sometimes. So that does, you know, have a different kind of category, but it's treated the same as type 1 in children, whether you develop it as a child or as an adult.
Okay. And what are some precursors and risk factors for diabetes?
Yeah, so I was actually just looking this up yesterday because I thought I need to brush up on this. So it's interesting, you know, ethnicity can play a role. So individuals that are African American or Latino are more likely to develop just because of genetic predisposition. People who, you know, have a higher BMI, and BMI is it's looking at is your weight proportional to your height. So if you're heavier, you know, are overweight or have obesity, you're more likely to develop type 2 diabetes because that's a more chronic, slower onset. And also, interestingly enough, like lower education level, like lower socioeconomic status, because if you think about it, you know, it does take some money to be able to afford living well and living healthy sometimes. So not having access to healthy food sometimes can really, you know, affect your risk factor.
Mm-hmm. Now, on a biological and anatomical level, what is happening with the person's body when they become diabetic? I know you kind of got into this a little bit earlier, but.
Yeah, so definitely. So there is, you know, a different, you know, kind of mechanism of action with the disease. If you have type 1, again, that's more autoimmune. So your body tissue is kind of attacking itself. So that has a different treatment. And then type 2, it can take a long time to develop. So type 1 can sometimes develop very quickly. Sometimes it's even after a virus or after an infection. But type 2 typically takes a longer time to develop because it's just more of like a lifestyle disease.
Okay. Now, can a person be cured from diabetes, or is it really just a lifelong chronic struggle?
I mean, there is no cure. So with type 1, because it's autoimmune, you would have to take insulin multiple times per day for the rest of your life. With type 2, there is kind of an emerging area of research in which we're calling, you know, diabetes in remission. So if it's caught early, if you're dedicated to making kind of a drastic lifestyle shift, you may be able, you know, to what we call put it in remission with a really low level of medicine or with no medicine. But it kind of depends on when you're diagnosed.
Okay. And how about gestational diabetes? If a woman develops that during pregnancy, does that end after pregnancy, or is that a chronic issue then moving forward as well?
Yeah. So for many women, it just resolves after pregnancy because there's just so many hormones involved with pregnancy. It can kind of, you know, resolve. But if you do have gestational diabetes, you definitely are at risk for developing type 2 later in your life. So you want to, you know, be aware of that and get your routine health screenings.
So the gestational can even be a precursor in itself.
Yes, like exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Well, pivoting now slightly, what is, Dr. Diener, I think this is probably where you'll step in more. What is diabetic retinopathy?
Okay. So diabetic retinopathy is when you have a period, you know, extended period where you have diabetes, you may not know you have it, or you may have it and it's not controlled well. So the blood sugar is too high and the sugar in the nerve retina is also too high. So therefore the body cannot handle that. So it causes stress on those tissues. And what happens with the blood vessels is the walls of the blood vessels become leaky, and that's where you get the leakage of either blood or other substances. In the nerve itself, you know, the nerve is sending signals to the body because it's struggling, and then the blood vessels will then take the more drastic reaction, okay? And they'll create these new blood vessels that are not stable at all, and that can therefore lead to major problems. So that's kind of like the cascade. For some people, it can happen very slowly over time. I mean, it's kind of variable, you know, how it does happen you know, depending on the individual.
Certainly. Now, are certain kinds or types, I know Ms. Goulden just went over several, you know, the big three types of diabetes. Does what diabetic retinopathy is, does that, like, are certain kinds or types of diabetes more prone to lead to diabetic retinopathy?
I don't know. It's the diabetes in itself. It's more of the type, how long you've had it, where it's not controlled. So there may be other factors that may play into that, such as diabetes type 1 is younger people. So it's a lot of younger people, especially young adults, you know, they really struggle mentally and just to get healthcare for it. And so they may go uncontrolled for a long time at a young age. So for them, it may get worse at a younger age than, say, for a type 2 diabetic. Because for them, it would be older, and they still have to go through the, you know, psychological and practical effects of controlling it. So right. They were going to have this onset where they're more into the healthcare system already, so they may be able to take care of things more quickly. Mm-hmm. Just as far as some thinking. Yeah, go ahead.
This might be a silly question, but I don't want to assume anything. Do you have to be diabetic in order to develop diabetic retinopathy?
Okay, so for it to be, diabetic retinopathy, you have to be diabetic, but sometimes when people are in an early stage of retinopathy where they don't know, like, their health status, okay, mm-hmm. So it can mimic other things, okay. Other types of retinopathy, so anybody with any type of retinopathy, any kind of bleeding in the eye, especially, would have, like, a complete workup of, you know, all their labs and every blood test just to see if they would have something like leukemia, you know, diabetes and other things.
Mm-hmm. So I know you kind of just went over a lot of the risk factors and precursors for diabetic retinopathy. I don't know if there's any more to say than what you've already said, but mm-hmm. Once a person develops diabetes, is diabetic retinopathy an unavoidable eventuality? Like, is there any way to avoid it?
Okay, well, it's not unavoidable, but it is, you always say, even if it's controlled, there always is a risk. Mm-hmm. There always is a risk. You're never, like, no risk, no matter how controlled you may be. Yeah, so, right. But, I mean, there's a lot of prevention that can be done, mm-hmm. especially if things are caught early on. And then, you know, your diabetes is controlled better more early on.
Okay. I know earlier you were kind of explaining, like, on a biological, anatomical level, what's happening with the eyes, the leakage, the walls, and so forth. Was there more to explain as to what's happening with a person's eyes when diabetic retinopathy is occurring?
Okay, well, I mean, I can go through further what happens if it doesn't get under control and some things that are done to try to control it. So what happens is, you know, your blood sugar is high, so your biochemically speaking, your body has to handle this with these alternative pathways, as they call it. So that is what creates the instability and the stress on the system. And okay. So once that occurs, if you start to have a lot of leakage and the blood vessels forming, then the options are the injections and laser, okay, which sounds scary. And for some people, it is kind of scary to have it done and all that. Certainly. But that's the idea, is to control the leakage if they can identify spots where it's leaking, and also reduce the demand of the retina. So, and then if they can do that, then there's a good chance that people can slow down their progression.
Okay. So is diabetic retinopathy curable, or is it also just a lifelong chronic struggle that you kind of try to control it, maintain it through the injections and the lasers that you mentioned, and you just kind of slow its progression?
Well, I have seen people who have had retinopathy, have had their diabetes under control. Once they get their diabetes under control, and they may have had laser or something of the like, their mm-hmm. diabetes, like the active diabetes, does not return significantly.
Okay.
So, I mean, there may be residual damage in the eye, but you know, I have seen people where, again, they do not end up going down that path again.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, I mean, it's, that's why the eye exams are so important.
Certainly. Yeah. Now, is the frequency of diabetes in general on the rise in recent years, either nationally or globally?
Yeah. So I just looked at some national data, and it looks like in the last 20-year time period from 2001 to 2021, it did rise or increase. It didn't say significantly on the CDC website, but it did say, you know, it did rise or increase a little bit. And, and I personally just saw with COVID and kids, especially like kids and adults, but I saw more weight gain in the kids that I see here at Berks Community Health Center than in the adults. And we did have a few kids develop type 2 diabetes, you know, who were adolescents.
Just because a more sedentary, contained lifestyle.
Yeah. You know, yeah.
That would make sense.
Yep. So weight gain, you know, increased blood pressure as well.
Okay. Well, that would make sense for reason for increase, certainly. And I was curious, do you think that, I don't know, it's hard to say, but do you think the frequency of diabetes really is more common today, that more people really have it? Or is it that our medical science community has become able to identify and diagnose it quicker, to the point where just as many people have it today as always, the frequency is now what it has always been? We're just now getting to be aware of its prevalence. I don't know if it's hard, if you can land on that, but
yeah, so I think you're exactly right. We are just diagnosing it earlier, like earlier in the lifespan. You know, even in the last 5 to 10 years, there's been kind of a push in primary care medicine to identify pre-diabetes earlier. So I don't think it's necessarily that, you know, a ton more people are diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. I think that we are just kind of catching it earlier, and we're doing a little more screening, you know, for hemoglobin A1Cs and things like that during primary care visits.
Okay. Well, Dr. Diener, if diabetes is on the rise, or at least our knowledge of it is more on the rise, why is it that it seems like diabetic retinopathy is not a more common cause of vision loss amongst the visually impaired community?
Because diabetic retinopathy doesn't always attack like the central vision. Okay, so when you get the early features of it, it may not even affect the vision at all.
Mm-hmm.
So that's when you're getting the patient, you know, to work on their diabetes overall control and all that, so you can, you know, so you can address it from that stage to where it's not even affecting the vision. Whereas something like macular degeneration, that targets your central vision, that targets it, okay? And it's really unfair, but it does. And
sure,
there's unfortunately no systemic thing you can address, you know, to prevent that, because that is more of like a genetic and just, I mean, some lifestyle things, yes, like smoking and certain things, but it's mainly just age related. So there's not like, you can't address any factors to really prevent it 100%. And the treatments for that are not, because of where it's located in the central vision, it's like a very fragile area.
Mm-hmm.
The treatments, you know, there are treatments that do help, but it's only in like certain circumstances.
Right.
And it's kind of after the vision has already started to decrease. So.
Okay. And do you think on a big picture, do you think people even really care much about developing diabetes, or has there just become like a general apathy where people don't even really care, and it's just kind of an accepted, it's become so common that it's just accepted that it's an unavoidable component of getting older?
I think it kind of depends on the individual, and it also depends on what their exposure is to diabetes in their family. Okay. You know, I have worked with some people you know, who say, oh, this is just what happens in my family, you know, we all have it. But I try to come, you know, from a different perspective when I'm working with people, and well, this is also something that can be managed, and it can be something that can be, you know, not like a burden to your life. It can really be something that you take charge of and then have more control over.
Okay. And along those lines, what can people do to be proactive against developing diabetes? And for those who are already diabetic, what can they do to be proactive against developing diabetic retinopathy?
So just going and getting your regular routine health screenings, get the lab work that your provider orders for you, you know, take the medicine that's prescribed for you, and also work with your healthcare team on if you're not comfortable with the medicines or you have questions, you know, ask questions and really be involved, you know, and an active participant in your healthcare. Also, you know, eating a little bit better, like watching, you know, your sugary drink intake and your carbohydrate intake, maintaining like a regular activity practice, like taking walks or doing whatever activity you're comfortable with in your home. But also, you know, along with what I said about the lab work, like, you know, managing other things like your blood pressure and cholesterol can also contribute to your like long-term risks with diabetes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And okay. Go ahead, Dr. Diener, go ahead.
Yeah, so regarding the retinopathy, to prevent the worsening, just obviously get your regular eye exams, which insurance does now cover as a preventive service. Okay, they didn't always cover it on the medical side for prevention. So even Medicare and your primary care doctor really wants you to get your eye exam. So there's that. Secondly, if you do notice problems with your vision, like blurry vision, you know, spots in your vision, don't assume, oh, it's I just need glasses and I'll just, you know, wait on that and not get it checked. You just want to make sure to get yourself checked out if you do feel there's a problem.
Certainly. Okay. Now, should people address their concerns with managing and preventing diabetes and diabetic retinopathy with their family doctor and with their eye doctor? Or is there really a specific doctor that people should consult with, you know, that specializes specifically in diabetes and diabetic retinopathy?
I mean, really, you would start with your primary care provider. Like, you know, very often if your diabetes is caught early, you know, and your blood sugar stay within range, you can really just work with your primary care team to manage your diabetes. You don't need a special doctor per se, but, you know, if you have a more maybe complicated treatment regimen, like if you're on an insulin pump or you take insulin multiple times per day, sometimes your primary care team may refer you to see an endocrinologist.
Okay.
Okay, and so regarding the eyes, yes, just your eye doctor is the one to go to. The optometrist is more easily accessible typically, so make an optometry appointment. If there are any concerns, you know, any problems starting up, then you would be referred to a retina specialist.
Oh, okay. Okay. So ultimately, if you get to that point of specialty, it's the endocrinologist for diabetes and the retina specialist for diabetic retinopathy. That's kind of like the end point.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so as we begin to close, you know, beyond what you guys have already said, where can people go to learn more about diabetes in general and diabetic retinopathy in particular?
So just for general diabetes information, I think the CDC website is a great resource. The American Diabetes Association has a great website as well with lots of, you know, awesome PDFs and handouts. If you're looking for some like diet advice, you know, you could always see a registered dietitian as well. But if you're just looking online for some information that's credible and evidence-based, eatingwell.com has some great 7-day meal plans that were designed for by a registered dietitian.
Okay, and then as far as the eye, the National Eye Institute has a lot of information as well. And these national organizations do have their own like YouTube channels. So anybody can go on and watch a video or listen to a video. You could even listen in different languages. So there's a lot of ways to access.
That's great that they make that so accessible.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right, Dr. Diener and Ms. Goulden, well, thank you both so much for joining us. We really appreciate your time and your willingness to come and on the show and speak to this important topic. Like I said, it's at the beginning, it seems like diabetes has just become so commonplace. And yet, while we've all heard of it, not many people know a whole lot about it. And so thank you for taking the time to help educate us and help us to have a better, more full comprehension of what's going on with diabetes and then what it can ultimately lead to with how it can impact a person's vision via diabetic retinopathy. So thank you both. We appreciate your time.
Thank you. I'm glad to help.
Yep. And to our viewers, thank you for joining us. Maybe this wasn't necessarily the topic you wanted to hear about as we go into the holidays with all our cookies and pies and cakes and holiday eating, obviously a lot of sugar and carbohydrates there, as we talked about, not the best for diabetes, but hopefully this was an enjoyable program for you nonetheless. Just so everyone is aware, coming up on December 6th, Vision Resource Center will be holding a social and recreational activity. We are going to Boscov's Berkshire over in Wyomissing to receive assistance with Christmas shopping from the store employees. And then following that, we're going to go over to Ruby Tuesdays for lunch within the mall. And then on December 20th, we're going to have our annual Lunch Bunch Christmas and holiday party. So if anyone wants to know more about those activities, just contact me, Mark Levengood, at 610-375-8407, extension 120. And once again, we thank you for joining us. We hope everyone has a very Merry Christmas and happy holiday season and Happy New Year to everyone. And we look forward to seeing you in January 2024. Thanks so much.
Insight on BCTV is supported by the Vision Resource Center.